Thank you, Rafael and Eric, for that inspiring discussion. I'm honored to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Sophie Vandebroek, who's the Chief Operating Officer of IBM Research. Sophie is well known to many of us here at MIT. She has been serving on the Dean's Advisory Council for the School of Engineering for the last decade and was a member of the board of the MIT Sandbox Innovation Fund for the first few years. She recently played an instrumental role in the creation of the MIT-IBM Watson AI Lab, a new collaboration for research on the frontiers of artificial intelligence. The MIT-IBM Watson AI Lab has inspired exciting research partnerships and provided MIT with new resources, colleagues, and tremendous access to real-world data and computational power. We have received tremendous interest in participating from PIs across campus. We took their enthusiasm as a directive. Today, we're launching the MIT Intelligence Quest and owe a lot of its momentum to our cornerstone collaborator, IBM. I'm thrilled that Sophie has joined us today to provide an update on the lab and its research direction. Please join me in welcoming Sophie.
Let me thank Anantha, because the first week he became dean, he and I had lunch and discussed his opportunity to build a super strong AI research community here on the East Coast. Less than 6 weeks later, that picture was taken in the middle where the actual agreement was signed. So it was a lot of trust and a great opportunity, and I'm delighted that we have at least a decade, right? Luckily, hopefully more, a $240 million joint investment, 100 researchers and PIs between MIT and IBM working on super important projects that will impact billions of people around the globe. So the lab has a portfolio across four pillars. And I thought the best way of showing you what's going on is to give you a peek in the initial projects that are being funded. So about 300 PI submitted projects. We selected 37 or so projects across these four areas. The first area, and we discussed this a lot today, the first area is all about the core AI algorithms pushing the boundaries of explainability, are working with limited data, as well as applying AI capabilities to industries. I mean, so just a couple blocks from here is where the lab is headquartered. It's co-located with IBM Research Lab on Binney Street. We also have our healthcare, Watson for Health headquarters in the same building, as well as Watson Cybersecurity, so as well as the Watson Cloud business. So all these businesses jointly are funding this lab, and we wanted to make sure we had also projects that were application focused to these different, at least to security as well as healthcare. So let me give you a couple projects. This is actually one that already is bearing fruits. We just open sourced or launched this moments in time database, where we have about, it's not a database, it's over a million videos that have been annotated, very similar to ImageNet. Those of you that know ImageNet with static images, these are short actions, 3 second actions that have been annotated, and every action has more than 2,000 videos annotated. And why is that important? For example, if you see on a picture somebody in a door, you don't quite know if they're going maybe inside or outside, what way they might be going if the door is open, right? And so in the 3 seconds, you can really look at actions, and then these actions put together, you can then apply them in everything from autonomous cars to security situations to healthcare situations. And what the purpose is to really have pre-trained AI models such that with little additional data, you can fine-tune these models for the particular problem or workflow that you're trying to make more secure or make more safe or make better or personalized. So another issue with limited data or area where there's a lot of limited data is in healthcare. For example, in hospitals have medical records of a couple thousand patients. But again, that is not enough to be able to really train these deep neural networks to understand certain diseases, for example. And so in each of the slides, each of the projects I'm showing, I showed both MIT as well as IBM PI. All these projects are joint projects. So in this particular project, we're going to be focusing on leveraging the rationale a physician, for example, writes down to decide whether or not a certain disease exists, and highlighting that not only to more quickly agree of what the particular disease is, and in this case we can give an example related to cancer, but also to provide some explainability, to be able to have the algorithm say, okay, this is why I believe it is skin cancer, because of the color or the border or the asymmetric shape. So to give explainability, because right now a lot of deep learning algorithms are truly black boxes. And this builds trust and obviously is super critical for physicians to be able to explain the why to their patients, or for insurance companies to be able to explain the why if something is rejected or if certain, and not just blame it on the algorithm or say the algorithm told me so. So in addition, if a neural net makes a mistake, for example, in this case, there is a little girl brushing her teeth, but the AI said she's washing dishes. And so it's wrong. Again, it's a black box. Today, we don't know what's going on. But there is a research program ongoing that will be able to look at what are the biggest neurons in the network that define this wrong output, and then be able to go in and understand why. And so the similarity is, and we could envision, like for software, debugging software, that is actually a debugger for neural nets, which again is super critical when you talk about situations where these AI algorithms are going to be used to make important decisions. Okay, so now moving on. Today we heard an enormous amount about what AI can do, the applications, the algorithms. We have not talked a lot about another topic, which is really the physics of AI. I mean, equally important is that we continue to design the hardware that will enable AI to be ubiquitously present all around us, all the way to the edges for inferencing at super low cost, super high efficiency, of course, significant processing power for training very complex AI algorithms. So on the left here, you see an image. This is today's hardware. Today's hardware, it went from CPUs in the early 2010s. Around 2012, two things happened. Number one, the neural net, deep learning started to win some of these competitions. This is a competition that showed classification of images, as well as everybody started switching to GPUs. And that enabled this combination together, enabled ultimately in this competition, the system to be better than humans. There's also a lot of custom silicon emerging, silicon ASICs, to do inferencing or learning of specific neural nets. Our point of view at IBM is that clearly the silicon space is going to run out of steam, as we all know, due to Moore's Law, et cetera, and that we have to move back, you can say, to analog computing so that many of these synapses are the neuron on the network, the multiplication, the math that's happening, you can actually move it into the memory, and you can then see that by doing so, our projections are that you can increase again by a factor of 1,000. What does that mean? That means that you could do real-time imaging diagnosis on patients, for example, looking at the images while doing the operation. I mean, there is instead of waiting and for the image processing to be done afterwards, so things will just go 1,000 times faster. And so one of the projects here is with this team that is really good at looking at energy-efficient algorithms. The team has done it in the silicon space. We're now going to look at applying that into the analog space with these special in-memory devices. We're looking both at the materials, the devices, and the circuit or system level. But then beyond analog computing, there is quantum computing. And right now, IBM has the best quantum system in the world. We have 50 qubits running in the research lab. In fact, we have open sourced our quantum hardware. as 70,000 researchers and others around the globe have done experiments on the quantum hardware, 2 million experiments total, technical publications published. And so we are now looking at applications of quantum to AI, right? I mean, what is going to be the difference if we apply quantum computing to AI? A couple projects in this area, actually too many to mention and put pictures on. And so in addition to doing the actual projects, we have also funded an EDX course. All of you can go take it. On the basics of quantum computing, because obviously this is, for most of us, a very new computing approach, and so many of us have to come up to speed. And so there is a course, it's just launched, and already almost 4,000 people have signed up from many different countries around the globe. So finally, the last topic that we wanted to have a pillar of investment around gaining shared prosperity with AI. These are the topics, it covers the topics that were discussed at the panel earlier today, right? How do we create moral AI, AI, ethical AI? What is the impact of AI on jobs, all of our jobs? And so that there was a lot of discussion at the panel, so in the interest of time, I won't show a specific project, but we thought that is a fundamental ticket to the game in working on AI is to make sure that we look at it from impact on society, and what does it mean to the future of the world. So let me end with the principles that our CEO has for AI, or with for IBM, for our company in this AI era. And so we look at three principles. You can see them here. The purpose of the work we do is to augment humans, right? It's an AI system and human working together. Then also very important is transparency, that everything we do has to be trusted and has to be ethical. And that's why making sure that, that there is privacy and security and explainability is super, super critical. And again, a lot of scientists have to help us make sure that we continuously put that principle in front of us. And the final principle is skills. You can see it in how we're launching this quantum course together with EDX, but also IBM was one of the founding members of the PTAC schools, which has, by it's like high school, early college, about 12,000 students have been trained in how to use and live with these AI systems, how to interact with them, and then how to be the new color workers of the future. And these principles, I'm so delighted because they're very much aligned with MIT's principles. And so together with MIT, IBM is also delighted to that MIT has built on this foundation for IQ Intelligence Quest. And so looking forward to work together with MIT and many of the other partners that will be part of it. Thank you.